So let us now start. Please, this is the title of this talk. Now, actually, I would be co concentrating on the different aspect of sensors in material science from bulk to nano. Before going into the detailed discussions, let us now try to introduce a brief introduction to classification of materials. Please, next. So, let's confirm for you.
हमारा देश और पूरा विश्व आज कोविड-19 की चुनौती का सामना कर रहा है।
হ্যালো দা প্রেজেন্টেশন হচ্ছে?
হ্যাঁ, আমি আমি দেখতে পাচ্ছি। তুমি তো তোমার স্ক্রিনে কি দেখতে পাচ্ছ?
হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ দেখতে পাচ্ছি, ঠিক আছে তো?
ব্যাস,
তাহলে
হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ
কন্টিনিউ
হ্যাঁ
করছি, হ্যাঁ,
হ্যাঁ ইয়েস ইয়েস
এবং আমি তো এটা অপারেট করতে পাচ্ছি,
ও তাহলে তো ভালোই গেল। না, এটা আমি করছি।
এটা আমি করতে পাচ্ছি। তো
ওকে,
চেঞ্জ হলো,
না চেঞ্জ হয়নি।
হয়নি?
না, আমি আমি তো প্রেজেন্টেশনে চলে গেছি, আমি আর দেখতে পাচ্ছি না।
ও আচ্ছা আচ্ছা, তাহলে আমি এটা যেটা দেখছি ভুল দেখছি।
হ্যাঁ, ওটা তোমারটা দেখছো, আমি তোমার তোমার স্ক্রিনে আসতে হবে।
হ্যাঁ 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 ঠিক আছে, আমি তাহলে
আমি আবার প্রেজেন্ট করছি।
হ্যাঁ তুমি প্রেজেন্ট করে দাও তাহলে, 2 নম্বর থেকে শুরু করে দাও। হ্যাঁ ঠিক আছে, ওকে। সো লেট আস, ইফ উই কনসিডার দ্য হোল মেটেরিয়ালস, ইফ উই জাস্ট ওয়ান্ট টু ক্লাসিফাই দ্য মেটেরিয়ালস, সো দের উইল বি টু গ্রুপস ইন ব্রড সেন্স, ক্রিস্টালাইন গ্রুপ অ্যান্ড অ্যামোরফাস গ্রুপ। অ্যান্ড ক্রিস্টালাইন মিনস ইউ নো দ্যাট ক্রিস্টালাইন মেটেরিয়ালস আর নর্মালি মেনটেনিং দ্য সিম অ্যারে অ্যান্ড স্ট্রাকচার। And in crystalline, there are mainly different type of materials like single crystal, polycrystal, nanocrystal, etc. And amorphous, actually, if you see from the point of classification from crystalline system and amorphous system, you see that in crystalline system there will be a regular array of atoms in the microscopic region, and it will be continued till the boundary limit, till the boundary, whereas in amorphous it will not be happened. And owing to this advantages in crystalline system, so different avenue are found in the single crystalline family, whereas in polycrystalline or nanocrystalline family there are also different aspect. And in amorphous, though the array or regular repetitions may be maintained within the very narrow region, I mean my nanoscopic or microscopic region, but it will not be maintained till the boundary of the material. Here you see the different groups of crystalline systems. For example, triclinic system, monoclinic system, orthorhombic system, tetragonal system, rhomboidal system, hexagonal system, and cubic system. And if you go from lower symmetry to higher symmetry, you see that the if you go from tetragonal to from triclinic to cubic system, then you see that the symmetry is being increasing. So there is no if so in the crystalline family there are seven primitive groups. That means triclinic, monoclinic, orthorhombic, trigonal, and if you what is the lowest symmetry group? That is the triclinic symmetry group. So in the crystalline family, triclinic means there is no symmetry in the unit cell. That means the lattice vectors a1, a2, a3 are not equal, and also at the same time the angles between the lattice vectors A, B, C are not equal to 90 degree, and they are not equal. and minimum symmetries being found, monoclinic system, orthorhombic system, trigonal system. So the maximum symmetry is the cubic symmetry group. So in the crystalline family, these are the basic trend. And here you see that if you are interested to have to manipulate the symmetry, just our main main mission is to correlate the application of sensor. So you can exploit the symmetry. You can exploit the symmetry structure of the crystalline system in different manifold applications. That's why I would like to highlight all these symmetry groups. So symmetry will dictate the physical property, and physical property will dictate the application. So these are all intimately related. So everything is related. So the symmetry of the system and the symmetry structure, so these are intimately related to one another. Now coming, so these are the crystalline system, and the symmetry is also being maintained in the nano dimension also. I will be talking later on regarding the details of nano. Now next, go the classification of nanomaterials. Next, here you see that the classification of nanomaterial, normally we, what is zero dimension, zero dimensional material? Zero dimensional materials means a nano dimension in all the three directions. What is nano? Nano means, you know, 10 to the power minus 9 meters. So 10 to the power minus 9 meter means nano. So if you design the material, if you fabricate the material zero dimension, that means you have to confine the dimension of the material in three direction nano. And what is one dimensional? Next, one dimensional means, so there is only two direction. Here you see that one dimensional have nano dimensions in two directions. So if you for example, thin film or in any in that case, you can for example, the graphene nano sheet, there are enormous applications, not in sensor technology, in different aspects. So basically this is one dimensional material. That's why it is so important. And one dimension means two directions are nano. Next, please. And what is two dimensional? That means two dimensions of the nanostructure will be outside the nanometer range. Two direction, so only one direction will be in the nano dimension. And next, so example here you see that nanoparticle, and three dimensional. Three dimensional means all dimensions outside the nanometer range. So first of all, I have already mentioned the structure. So structurally, if you classify the materials from the structural point of view, that is amorphous, crystalline. Within the scope of crystalline, there are different groups, and within the crystalline family, there are different groups. Even from the dimensional point of view, you see that zero dimensional, one dimensional, two dimensional, three dimensional, and from so nano may be in three dimension. Nano means three dimensions, or maybe in the bulk form also. So in the bulk state, you may find the nano, or nano in the nano three dimensions, maybe a nano three dimensions, maybe a bulk. Okay, so please go to the next slide. Now what is a sensor? Now sensor, you know all that already you have acquainted so many features of sensor. Actually, my main intention to discuss about the application of material science in the sensor. So what is the role of sensor? You know, basically there will be input and there will be output. And basic understanding of any sensor is to detect or sense any response from physical environment and deliver the desired output. For example, if I concentrate on the measurement of temperature, basically a sensor based. So what is the sensor? Now thermocouple may act as a sensor. What is thermocouple? Thermocouple means basically to junction of two materials. So junction of materials. So thermocouple will sense. What is the sense? The sense means environmental temperature. So if you consider the two ends of junction of a thermocouple with different temperatures, there will be an EMF. So difference of temperature will give you the idea of measuring the temperature. So this is the very basic physics behind the measurement of temperature by means of a thermocouple sensor. So basically, what are you doing? Now you are doing just sense of what? A sense of environmental temperature. And this sense temperature, you are getting the EMF, and this EMF you can feed into another device, electronic device, that will display accordingly. For example, if I calibrate the system, so this will be the EMF, accordingly this is the temperature by which you can design the thermocouple sensor as a temperature measurement. That is, basic understanding of any sensor is to detect or sense any response from physical environment and deliver the desired output. Input, in this case, in the case of thermocouple, the input or the environmental sense is the temperature. So you see, the temperature may be the input, maybe the electromagnetic radiation like light, heat, infrared, UV ray, X-ray, microwave, radio wave, moisture, pressure, or anything else related to environmental phenomena or other issues also. So these are the basic key understanding of any sensor. So the role of material is nothing but to sense the light or to sense the heat or to sense the infrared or UV ray. And the sense of the material, the material will sense the light. So material must have some property so that it can sense the light. Accordingly, I can design my desired goal. So the material will be the basic role, will play the crucial role for the measurement of anything or to sense that. So these are the basic input. So there may be a large variety of input, and these input is intimately related to physical property, maybe intimately related to chemical property, maybe related to biological property, or something like that. So all things are to be correlated. The output is again generally a signal. Output will also a signal that is converted to human readable display at the sensor location. So basically, what is sensor? Sensor is nothing but input output, and in the midway there will be a role of role of material. So and role of material nothing, the property of the material. So property may be is to be exploited. Next, please. And also sensor is a device which can detect the variable quantity, usually electronically, and converts the measurement into specific signal. The most important requirement of sensor are diversity, sensitivity, accuracy of information extracted, selectivity, and stability. And please do next. And here you see, this is the different types of sensors. Just I think it is visible: color sensor, gas sensor, a light dependent resistance sensor, proximity sensor, ultrasonic sensor. So these are all the group of sensor. And if you think intimately, that for each sensor, the main or crucial role is the material. Please next. And now, daily life application, sensors are used in everyday object. So this is also applicable in every automatic door open or light on or off, fire alarm, gas leaking sensor, digital thermometer, and etc. Next. So you see that more or less different types of sensors are being displayed here. Next, please. Next. So, just I would like to highlight the different features and applications with the advances in micro machinery, easy to use microcontroller. So, role of microcontroller is also highly important in the modern aspect of science and technology. And model and behind the role of microcontroller, there is basically the sensor. The uses of sensor have expanded beyond the traditional field of temperature, pressure, or flow measurement. Moreover, analog sensor such as potentiometer, force sensing registers are still widely used. Application include manufacturing and machinery, airplanes, airspace, cars. Next, please. Okay. Now, types of sensor. This is basically the self-generating sensor. Maybe here you see that energy form one is being transduced to energy form two. Another modulating sensor, energy form one to energy form two, to via modulated energy form two being modulating, and then we are getting energy three. Next, driving forces to invest research on sensor materials. Now, beside the main two fields, science and medicine, sensors are applied in many different applications. These fields, which are driving forces for the development of sensor materials, are automated manufacturing, processing, consumer product, military applications. So these are the avenues. You are all acquainted with the applications of the wide varieties in our daily life and in our everyday activities. Please, next. Driving life cycle management, government issues, and by example, sensors to measure gaseous emissions, safety related areas, assessing the integrity of aircraft. Next, these are the role of material scientist. What would be the role of material scientist? It is now clear that the field of engineering and sensor technology cannot search for new sensor material which are ideal, because different applications, easy different transformers of energy or different goals for sensor require different materials. However, materials are important drivers in sensor technology. So materials are the important driver. You have to focus on the features, that important driver. Without this driver, you cannot run the sensor technology. That's it. Next, and this is where the role of material scientists comes into existence for discovering new, smarter, cheaper, more reliable material for sensor development. So to have the advancement of sensor technology, it is highly necessary to concentrate on the development of new, smarter, cheaper, more reliable materials for sensor development. Please, next. Physical sensor category includes, and there are different physical property, maybe intimately related from the point of physics, temperature, strain, force, pressure, displacement, position, velocity, acceleration, optical radiation, sound, flow rate, viscosity, electromagnetic field, all the physical properties. Similarly, all the chemical properties are to be exploited, are to be used for the development of sensor material. And one of the sensors which are highly interesting, are one of the main research topics these days, are sensor of piezoelectric material, PZT. Next. Now, I will just discuss a little bit about piezoelectric material. What is the piezoelectric material? Now, these materials become electrically charged when they are subjected to a force and therefore gets physically changed. Just you see the you see the features that electrically charged, then force, therefore physical charge. So the mechanical energy is being transformed to electrical energy and the material is deformed. And accordingly, there will be a stress or strain. With these properties of piezoelectric material are applicable for different purposes. So this is basically the properties of a material, and you can utilize these properties for the development of sensor. Next, ceramic materials. The ceramic materials that include oxides, nitrides, carbides, silicates are typically synthesized as fine powders and are mainly used in the form of thin film, single crystal, polycrystal, composite materials. And also, if you have the property of positive temperature coefficient PTCR for ceramic, then that will be helpful for the development of different sensors. And these are the basic features, for example, platinum wire, ceramic tube, nickel chromium heater, as nanofiber. These are the basic basic development of the material in the field of ceramic. So ceramic material is also an important advantage. Development of ceramic material is also an important advantage in the field of sensor technology. Next, positive temperature coefficient. Positive temperature coefficient, actually, what is the physics behind it? Now, physics is positive temperature coefficient resistance are primarily donor doped. Donor doped means either lanthanum 3 plus dope or neodymium 3 plus dope or yttrium 3 plus dope, solid solutions of barium titanate, ceramics of large grain size, particularly 50 microns. And substitution of the trivalent ions produces a barrier layer effect and consisting semiconducting grains and insulating grain boundaries. So positive temperature coefficient materials are being designed for application in the field of sensor. Next, high resistivity of grain boundary. Actually, if you have the grain boundary, there will be high resistivity at ordinary temperatures due to ferroelectric polarization, resulting in the low resistance material. This condition is reversed at the Curie temperature. Why is it reversed? Because above Curie temperature, there will be a loss of ferroelectricity and accordingly resulting in several orders of magnitude rises in resistivity. So there will be a change in the resistivity, and this property can be exploited for the large change of resistivity. And if, for example, if the temperature change is very sharp, then it will be very useful for the measurement of temperature or measurement of anything else in the field of sensor technology. So this property can be utilized for development of sensor technology. So I basically, what is the role of material? The role of material is to find, so that is to achieve the property so that that can change. If there is a sharp transition, then it will be helpful for the measurement of sharpness. That means accuracy will be enhanced. For example, I would like to change them. I would like to measure the temperature change, for example, 10 to the power minus 3 Kelvin. How is it possible? So for this purpose, I have the property so that that will change within this narrow region. Otherwise, it is not possible. This is a simple requirement of material. So if the resistance of the material is being changed within very narrow range, for example, 10 minus 3 Kelvin, then the resistance will change accordingly, and accordingly I can measure the temperature. So this is basically intimately related. Just physical properties being intimately related to the sensor technology. So there is a sharp change in property, and accordingly there will be a sharp advantages in the sensor technology. This is the basic understanding in every where in the development of sensor technology. That I would like to mention. Please, next. Now, composite materials. What is composite materials? Now, in the field of nano, composite is a common terminology. Composite means, for example, I have one material. Composite means I have single crystallographic phase material. So single crystallographic phase material cannot have the desired property. But if I have a composite with some other crystallographic phase, and if I prepare the composite, then maybe physical property or my desired physical property may be more. And accordingly, I can enhance the accuracy. Accordingly, I can enhance the quality. So, role of composite in the field of material science is also an important aspect. For example, PZT. PZT, lead, zirconate, titanium. This is a very famous material. May be incorporated in polymer matrix. Polymer, you know, polymer may be conducting, polymer may be non-conducting. So, according to your need, you can utilize the property of PZT in the composite system of polymer. So, if I have the limitation for PZT, for example, from the context of conductivity, from the context of electrical conductivity, etc. In that case, I can utilize the development of composite. So in that case, you can incorporate PZT in the conducting polymer if you want, and if you need to raise the resistivity, you can incorporate the PZT in the insulating polymer. Accordingly, you can design or you can fabricate the sensor according to your need. So development of composite is also playing an important role for the development of sensor, because you are interested to exploit the piezoelectric property in the environment where you need the resistance high. How do you know? How do you proceed? In that case, you can think about the development of composite system. So development of composite system in the context of sensor technology is also important aspect. So next. Now, just a little bit, I have already described a little bit about nanotechnology. Why nanotechnology? Actually, what is the difference between bulk and nano? Let us understand what is the difference between bulk and nano. Bulk means, for example, you have a single crystal. So, single crystal means if you reach the microscopic wall within a material, for example, microscopic wall may have the dimension of angstrom or may have the dimension of 10 nanometer by 10 nanometer by 10 nanometer. So, you enters into the world of the materials in the microscopic or nanoscopic domain having size or volume 10 by 10 by 10 nanometers. But if it is single crystal, then you see if you move across in every direction, you will not get any change. You will see the repetitive pattern of the structure. I mean, if it is cubic, then you will see the cubic structure. But if you have the nano, then within the microscopic or nanoscopic wall, there will be a nano grain or nanoparticle. And nanoparticle itself may be a single crystal, may not be a single crystal. Two or three single crystal may couple to form a nanoparticle. So, normally a nanoparticle, we are talking about nanoparticle, which is consisting of large number of nanocrystallites. Maybe within the nanocrystallite basically the miniature of the single crystal. So, nanotechnology means you are entering into the domain of nano. That means you are fabricating the material in the nanoscale structure. And there are so many advantages whenever you can enter into the nano world. nanoparticles, here you see that nanoparticles attach to the carcinogenic cell. So nanoparticle can be attached to a carcinogenic cell, and if the nanoparticle is being attached with a drug, and then nanoparticle together with the drug may act as a medicine for the particular point, which is not possible by means of bulk. So nanoparticle can do this job. So nanotechnology based on microprocessor, here you see that nanotechnology based on microprocessor. So here you see that electronic device with carbon nanotube, very, very famous in the field of material science, and these are highly potential material in the sensor technology. Next. Now, just what is the motivation of nanotechnology? Motivation of nanotechnology, that means, you know about the famous scientist Feynman, who delivered a famous talk in 1958. There's plenty of room at the bottom, and that was the famous lecture from which the birth of nano science and nanotechnology began. And you are also acquainted with the Moore's law, that if you lowering the dimension, what will be the end? And what is the alternative? And people are also trying to find the solution. Now, there are different key advantages, because you see, there's plenty of room at the bottom. That means if you have the machinery, to explore the materials by entering in the nano regime, then you will get enormous scope, enormous avenue, and accordingly you can enrich your science and technology. That's the beauty of nanotechnology. First of all, surface to volume ratio, I, greater amount of substance comes in contact with surrounding material. And this is the very easy demonstration, that whenever you go into the nano and lower nano, in that case, you will increase the surface to volume ratio, and accordingly, you can change the property. And this is the beauty of nano. This results in better catalyst, since a greater proportion of the material is exposed for potential reaction. So if you increase the surface, that means you are exposing the surface to the environment or to the reactant greater way. Accordingly, the purpose will be more. Next. Now, uniqueness of nanotechnology. Uniqueness that is not possible to find in any scale. Macro scale, you see that changing an object size has a very small effect on the percentage of atoms on the surface. And nanoscale, that means in the macro domain, it is doing nothing. But in the nano regime, changing an object size has a big effect on the percentage of atoms on the surface. For example, a property, melting point, does not depend on the macro size particle. However, melting point is lower for smaller particles. This is just one example. That means in the macro scale, there is a very, very minimum scope to exploit the property or to change or modulate the property. Maybe physical, maybe chemical, maybe thermal, maybe optical, maybe anything else. But in the nanoscale, there is an enormous scope to change the material property, either from physical point of view, chemical point of view, optical point of view, or anything else. So if you have the scope to change, that means you are opening so many doors. and so many avenues and so many advantages. Accordingly, you are enhancing the potential for applications in every field. So this is the key understanding. This is the basic difference between macro, bulk, and nano. In the nano regime, there are enormous scopes to modulate the properties. Whereas, same material in the bulk state, the scope is very, very limited. Next. Uniqueness continued. Electronic property. Just I am here displaying one example. If I start with atom, just you see the picture, atom, then you go to the molecule. And then large number of molecule form a nanoparticle. Large number of nanoparticle form a material, semiconductor, and then or metal. Normally, you see here that you are all acquainted with the Bohr's law, hydrogen atom problem. That means atom, that is the label, are discrete. If you have the molecule, then you will encounter the molecular orbital level. And whenever you are forming nanoparticle, you see the nanoparticle, the spacing between the energy level minimized. Whereas in the solid, there is a formation of band. Band means it is difficult to isolate, or the large number of energy are staying very, very close to each other. So these are the developments of atomic energy levels or energy levels. If you go from single atom to a solid. So electronic properties, band structure is being changed by size and dimension. A semiconductor's band gap already exists in bulk state. As the size of the metal nanoparticle decreases, they tend to lose their metallic character. Interesting property you note. If you decrease the size, then ultimately it cannot maintain the metallic properties. That's an important aspect. So that's why I am talking about that in the nano domain, there is a large change. And that can be exploited in various issues. Please, next. Unique content. For example, YOLO. Normally, we know that gold is color. What is the color of gold? Color of gold is YOLO. But this is purely the bulk state. But you see, the color of the gold is different. Suspension of gold nanoparticles of various sizes. And accordingly, you see, the color of the gold nanoparticles are not gold. So the color depends on size and shape. So color. I am going to put a phone call. So color depends on the size of the nanoparticle, size of the grain within the system. And so physical property which are normally encountered with that gold means YOLO. No, it depends on the size and shape of the particle. Accordingly, dielectric property, optical properties will change, spectroscopic property will change. So every property is being dictating by means of its size, shape, etc. So whenever there are you can exploit the size. If you fabricate different size of gold nanoparticle in your laboratory, you will see the different colors. And accordingly, you can utilize this for your specific purpose. So domain is being expanded. So domain of application is being expanded. That's the beauty of the material within the, please next. Now, magnetic property, similarly, magnetic property will be changed enormously according to size, shape. You just see, normally we encounter the BH loop of any ferromagnetic material. So what is the ferromagnetic material? Ferromagnetic material, that means you will get a BH loop. But will this loop be maintained in the ferromagnetic system if you lower the size? No, that is interesting. So there are different aspects of magnetic state. Whenever you are lowering the size of the nanoparticle or size of the grain within the ferromagnetic system, so within the ferromagnetic system, you may achieve the state of paramagnetism. Within the ferromagnetic system, you may achieve the state of superparamagnetism. Within the ferromagnetic system, you may achieve the mixed state of ferromagnetism and paramagnetism or antiferromagnetism. So you are changing the properties by means of manipulating the size. So super paramagnetism, single domain, you are all acquainted about the domain in ferromagnetic system, even in ferroelectric system. But the meaning of domain is also being changed in the context of shape and size of the materials. So you can also fabricate the single domain particle, multi-domain particle. So what is the result? So you can exploit, you can change the physical property, you can change the magnetic property, optical property, electric property, dielectric property, spectroscopic property. Whenever a bulk enters into a nano, why? Electronic structure, band structure, everything is being changed. And accordingly, the application domain, quality of application domain has also been enormously increased owing to this large variety. The meaning of coercivity, meaning of saturation, meaning of remanence, etc. are being changed in the context of nanorigin. So please next. Now the potential impact. So accordingly the magnetic cell is being enhanced, and its application domain in the diagnostic purpose, particularly contrast agent in MRI scan, humans basically a sensor, magnetic resonance imaging, cancer treatment. Maybe you are acquainted with the term cancer treatment. Now, targeted drug delivery, that is based on the sensor. And sensor, it is a very, very sophisticated sensor, because you are coupling the nanoparticle with the biological organ. You are designing the drug, nanoparticle and magnetism, so that drug together with the nanoparticle will be focused whenever into the physical system. It will be guided by means of magnetic field, and it will target the cancer tumor only. So targeted. So a role of sensing being changed enormously with the advent of discovery of high potential magnetic materials. And so cancer treatment cell, you can utilize this property. So this is also the potential impact of nanotechnology in the field of material science and technology. Next. Now, next, another very important phenomenon, that is the quantum confinement. The quantum confinement, semiconductor crystal approaches the materials excite on board areas. So, if you now you are in a position to fabricate the semiconductor crystal within the limit of excite on board areas, that is interesting. And in that case, electron energy level can no longer be treated as continuous and must be treated as discrete. I have already shown some pictures, which means that there is a small and finite separation between energy level. And this is the basically quantum confinement. And this quantum confinement already experimentally established quantum dot. And the electrons in quantum dot have a range of energies, and all the quantum concepts such as energy level, band gap, conduction band, valence band are applied in quantum dots too. This has significant influence on the absorptive and emissive behavior of the semiconductor material. The band gap in a quantum dot will be always be energetically larger, and the radiation from a quantum dot blue shifted means you are just playing the shifting of spectroscopic energy level from left to right, I mean infrared to blue region to infrared region. So this is the control mechanism is in your hand, and if you need to exploit this property, you can have the advantage. So you can utilize the idea of quantum dot in the fabrication of sensor technology also. Next. Now here is the luminescence from suspension of colloidal cadmium selenium nanocrystal. Just you see the suspension size 1.7 to 4.5 nanometers from left to right under UV excitation. So color is not the fixed property, rather it depends on the size of the nanoparticle, and this material property may be exploited for any sort of applications in the field of science and technology. Next. Now, zero dimensional electronic structure quantum dot, which I have already mentioned, and this is the basic understanding. So we have already read the problem of particle in a box, but the problem of particle in a box can now be the problem can be verified by means of experiment. Cadmium selenium has a Bohr excitation 56 angstrom, and this has now been experimentally verified in the present development of science and nanotechnology. Next. So, what is the basic on decreasing the size of the particle in the nano? Accordingly, so-called confinement effect. And due to this, the following results are observed. Increase in band gap. You know, band gap is an interesting property. It plays an important crucial role in different aspects. Band gap levels gets quantized, discrete. Surface states or trap states which lie in the band gap become important. After the optical properties of nanocrystal, the energy level spacing increases with decreasing dimension and quantum size. So these are all the features you may exploit for the development of sensors in any field of. So development of research in the material science will help you for the development of sensor also. Next. This is the electronic band structure, electronic structure. This is the basically band structure So band structure is also being modulated by means of size that is displayed. So usual band structure in the bulk state is now being changed in the nano dimension also. Next. This is the basic, now this is the conduction which I have already described this, the conduction band and valence band and nanocrystal state. Next. This is the color representation which I have already told. So how color changes with the size of the nanoparticle, and also accordingly what is the band gap is also changing according to conduction band and valence band. If you increase the size of the nanoparticle from left to right, then you see the change accordingly, and accordingly you can observe the change in color also. So every property is being changed accordingly, a schematic representation of the quantum confinement effect. So five dispersion is being seen here. Next. So similar time present, decreasing size and accordingly the color. So color is not an absolute quantity, rather it depends on the size. Here it is again shown. Next. Okay, here you see the density of states. So density of states is an important parameter in the field of condensed matter or material science. So if you are interested to have the bulk semiconductor, what is the density of states? You see, this is the parabolic nature of the density of states. And what is the density of states in two-dimensional quantum well? You see. And what is the density of states in one dimension? You see the discrete state. And density of states in quantum dot, this is the... So you see the density of states changing with size. So bulk semiconductor, quantum well, quantum wire, and quantum dot. So property of a semiconductor is not unique. It depends on the size of the grain. So you can play the property, and accordingly you can utilize this property for the development of any technology. Next. This is the basically nano sensor. I have already in different field applications already I have mentioned anti-terrorism, leak detection, food quality control, chemical analysis of soil and atmosphere constituents. So these are the also there are other features application zone also. Next. So nano sensor application zones, these are mentioning another important application, environmental issues, ability of chemi resistant. So all these are the area of applications which I've already mentioned. Sensor detected various volatile organic compound produce, detecting for these phytochemical enables, the ability to detect important molecule such as disease related metabolites, protein, nucleic acid, pathogen, cell is important not only for disease diagnosis in the clinical setting and health technology, but also for industrial, environmental, and agriculture research development. Next. Nano sensor. Actually, the range of nano is not being fixed value. Still, people are saying that the size up to 100 nanometer. Up to 100 nanometer, you may treat the nano domain. And beyond that, not exactly nano. The nanostructured material used in production of nano sensor are nanoscale wire. So maybe nano wire, maybe nanotube, maybe thin film, maybe nanoparticle, polymer nanomaterial, carbon-based nanomaterial, etc. Next. Uh, These are the basic classification on the basis of receptor molecules, on the basis of structure, on the basis of applications. So, though there are different, directions, so these are the one way by which you can classify the materials. And I have taken this classification from recent publications in Journal of Applied Physics D. Next. Optical nanosensor and electromagnetic nanosensor. These are the different types of. Next. Mechanical nanosensor, chemical nanosensor. These are the different areas of applications. Basically, next. Nanomaterial applied for nanosensors, metal and noble metal nanomaterials. So, platinum, palladium, gold, copper, cobalt, etc. are very good element for applications in different aspects in the bulk and nano region also. Metal and noble metal nanomaterials. Next. Nanomaterials applied for nanosensors, gold nanoparticle, platinum nanoparticle, palladium nanoparticle. These are already well established nanoparticle in the field of material science, and metal oxide nanoparticles, tin oxide nanoparticle, zinc oxide, very, very important material in the field of material science because of its diverse applications, and nickel oxide nanoparticles, titanium oxide nanoparticles, carbon based nanomaterials, carbon nanotube, graphene, porous carbon, polymer and bio nanomaterials, polymer nanomaterials, bio nanomaterials. These are different group of nanomaterials, and all of these materials which are being mentioned here highly important in the context of science and technology. Next. Now I will discuss little bit about spintronics. I think time is very short. So what will be the estimated time maybe allowed, Dr. Anindo?
Now,
what is spintronics? Spintronics, the basic understanding is spin transfer electronics. Spin transfer electronics means in electronics, you know that the charge of electron is normally exploited in electronics, entire electronics. But in spintronics, not only charge, spin is also being used in electronics. And whenever you utilize both charge and spin, the dimension or avenue of application will be increased. So in spintronics, the beauty of spintronics is you are not only manipulating the charge of the electron, you are also manipulating the spin of the electron. And accordingly, spintronics is nowadays very, very important area of research in the field of material science. And also, application of spintronics will be high. But it is really difficult to exploit the spin in your, application area. For example, normally we are working in the quantum, computer, we are normally working in 2-bit system. We are all familiar with 2-bit system. But if we enhance this 2-bit system into 4-bit system, then that will be very, very interesting, and more avenue will be opened. So people are looking to develop that, to manipulate the spin in the stream transfer electronics. In ordinary materials, the up magnetic moments cancel the down magnetic moment. For example, electrons are flowing from one side to another side. We are not bothered about the spin in normal cases. But if you are bothered, for example, you are transporting the electrons from one end to another end without manipulating, without controlling the spin, one feature. And if you consider the spin in this transport mechanism, then charge will go up spin. So maybe two electron with parallel spin, two electron with parallel with anti-parallel flow. So with this consideration, there will be a four state, and accordingly you can enhance the ability of the application. Accordingly, if you design, then it will be helpful also in sensor technology, and it is now utilizing in different aspects. So here, ferromagnetic material is needed for designing spin electronic devices. Next. Now, classification of spintronic. Normally, spintronic materials dilute magnetic materials, dilute magnetic semiconductors, and dilute magnetic dielectrics. Why dilute? Dilute means doping is very, very low. And why magnetic? Now, once you dope, for example, zinc oxide. Zinc oxide, you know, that is a non-magnetic material. But if you consider the doping of cobalt 3 plus, in the zinc oxide, then maybe zinc oxide will show the ferromagnetic property. And that spin, that is dilute system. Now, doping concentration is very, very low. In that case, the spin concentration in the zinc oxide is also low. And if you consider the flow of this spin in the bilayer film, then it will be helpful for development of spintronics materials. And if the material is basically dielectric, then it will call dilute magnetic dielectric. And if the material is semiconductor, then it will say dilute magnetic semiconductor. This is the basic key understanding between dilute magnetic dielectric and dilute magnetic semiconductors. Next. Spintronics, these are the physical property by which you can classify the spintronic materials by measuring the magnetic property, by measuring the dielectric property, by measuring the resistivity, by measuring the optical property, etc. So you can, after characterizing the materials, you can observe whether it will behave as a spintronic system. And spintronic system, there are various avenues for applications, not only in sensor but also in other field also. Next. Now, there are the different family of spintronic system. For example, dysprosium oxide doped with cobalt, europium oxide doped with cobalt, or zinc oxide doped with cobalt, etc. Next. Now, these are the basic properties between spintronics at room temperature and the material which is not spintronic at room temperature. So, by which you can just measure the magnetic property, you can identify the spintronic system. Next. Now, ferrimagnetic materials, these are very, very interesting and potential materials for application as sensor in different regions. You can utilize the property of ferrimagnetism system, ferrimagnetic material. So you can also utilize, for example, gas sensor, chemical sensor, and other in different cases, you can utilize the property of ferromagnetic material. And also in the nano, you will get large avenue. So if you fabricate the material in the nano domain, then there will be enormous scope of applications. Next, ferromagnetic material structure, basically the face centered cubic structure. So from structurally, you can also manipulate the property, and also by doping and also by varying the doping constituents, you can change the property, and accordingly you can design this you can design the material for application in different sensor field. Next, these are the important next ferromagnetic materials. These are also different examples of ferromagnetic materials, and also you can apply the concept of composite for applications in different area. Next, these are the different examples of next. Now I will discuss another thing. This is cobalt, zinc, copper, ferrite nanoparticle incorporated in PVA matrix, and after incorporation you will see that this material will be useful for application in different sensor technology also. So just basically to manipulate the property or to exploit the property, we have to search for noble material, and in that context you have to search. So there are enormous scope to manipulate the physical, chemical and biological property of the material. Accordingly, you can think and work out your plan for design and fabrication. Next, and also you see that these materials are also highly important for dielectric applications, and accordingly you can use in different area of field. This is the just schematic view of the nanoparticles. These are the displayed nanoparticles. These nanoparticles is being fabricated in our laboratory, 20 nanometer, and this is the crystallographic structure, the SAD pattern, and this is the fringe pattern, and this is the distribution of size of nanoparticles, of ferrite nanoparticles in our level. This is grown at our laboratory. Next. Next, I'll mention another important topic. This is the last materials, and this is multiferroic. Multiferroic just means that is the ferroic properties, large number of ferroic properties, for example ferroelectric, ferromagnetic or piezoelectric, etc. That means different order parameters simultaneously coexist in a single phase material. That's why it is multiferroic. And owing to this multiferroicity, you can utilize this. And in multiferroics, you are getting so many avenue for applications in different zone. And the today's frontier researchers are concentrating their research on multiferroic system, spintronic systems, ferromagnetic systems, and for not only in the bulk but also in the nano regime for applications in different fields. And role of these materials is also highly important in the context of sensor technology. So I think the time is over, and let us now conclude this discussion. You may go to the last slide. So let us thank to you all let us, as the time is already over, so I am now concluding my talk. So there are microwave devices, so there are so many applications, biological field, chemical field, etc. So application area is high, so materials are highly important. So to design or fabricate a good material, you have to work out and you have to accordingly design the materials, and after that you have to measure and characterize the material property, and after that you can utilize this material for your purpose applications. So thank you all for your kind patience.
So thank you very much, Professor Chakraborty. I just want to make a single comment that some 20 years ago, when I purchased my first thumb drive, the cost was 3,400 rupees for 32 MB. And now we are purchasing for 600 rupees, maybe 32 GB. That was 32 MB. Okay. And now we are purchasing 600 to 800 rupees for 32 GB. So I think we, from the people of electronics, are becoming very happy that all the products, they are being very cheap, etc. But actually, behind us, you, the people are there, the material scientists, who are really making it happen. Once again, the things, when we are talking about sensors, it is coming before us that what is the real picture, why we are proceeding in the, why we could proceed in the field of sensors. Only thing is we do not have much time for questions. There are a few questions. I would request you, all the participants, to direct your questions to me so that I have always access to sir. So I would sum up all the questions and send him so that he can answer them, and I will share all the answers with all of you. And I would also request sir to be present in the today's evening interaction session or the networking session, any of the groups, and come into each of the groups so you may get some chance if it permits, because he's very, very busy in, because examinations are going on and also admissions are going on. So he's very busy there. If he can manage some time and come to us, participants have the chance to...
Okay, I shall try my best.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So once again, from all of us, thank you very much, sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay.